Okay, we'll start now. Good morning, all, and happy to join this meeting again with me. Last week, I was talking about the fire threat defense from Cisco. That is like a firewall, and it was doing a lot of other activities as well, like layer 4 to layer 7. It was, it was protecting our network and all. And today, we will see about FI load balancer. FI is good in the market, and many people are going for FI as well. And can you hear me properly, or anyone has any issues with listening to me in the meeting? Anyone, please?
Okay, looks good.
Okay, thank you very much.
It's
Thank you. So let me continue. Thank you very much. And so today we will talk about the FI load balancer. And this load balancer, I'm working on this load balancer for last 10 years, or I can say even more than that, And in the load balancer market, FI is always a number one that I can say, definitely. And there are a lot of other load balancers has come up. NGINX, which has been acquired by FI itself, and it is also doing a load balancing activities between the, containers and other things. A vLoad Balancer is there, AVA. That is also been promoted by the VMware networks and other peoples. And Citrix has got some kind of a load balancer that is called as a NetScaler or something is there. And every other cloud, when we have that, when we are configuring something on the cloud platform, we have the load balancers which are already given offer as a service on that. Like, so Elastic Load Balancer, it is called as in AWS. And some other like load balancers are there in Google Cloud also, as well as in Azure Cloud also, we can configure that. But when we talk about more functionalities, more features, activations, and other things, it is possible only through the FI or any other boxes which has been offered by the, the clients, the vendors as well, like I'm just saying that. But we are all very much standardized with our FI load balancers only. FI means it's like a refreshing. So in our keyboard, when we press the FI, it'll be like a refreshing. So refreshing, whenever the refreshing is happening, it'll be talked to the another server like that. So that is the idea behind that load balancing. Load balancing concept has been come up when there is a single point of failure cannot happen. Single point of failure in the sense, if there is a huge database has been there, people are accessing from all over the world or something, and they try to access it on just one server, in the sense it'll be a problem because it'll be a single point of failure may happen. So what normally we do that, we will be giving multiple servers sitting in behind, and there will be a LB will be put on top of it, put in front of it, I can just say that, like this. This is like an LB, this is an LB, and the servers are here, 1, 2, 3, like that, I can just say. The people who are coming from the outside, and they will go through this by seeing the load or traffic or CPU utilization or hard disk utilization or memory utilizations or number of connections which has been made on that. Like, so many algorithms are there on this. So we will be seeing all the algorithms on the coming, coming up slides and all, we will just see that. Before that, FI is been there for the market for last 10 years or more than that also. And they're expanding like the modules wise. They are integrating so many modules on FI. One is like an LTM, normally we talk about. LTM is called as a local traffic manager. And they come out with an idea called the GTM. That is nowadays it is called as a BIG-IP DNS, it is called. And there is an ASM is there, that is an application security module. And the APM is there, application profiling module, something like that. It goes on there. So many modules are there. So these all modules are can be activated in the FI box as a BIG-IP. It's called as a BIG-IP. On the FI box, we can activate these modules with the proper licensings. Then we will be able to run those, that particular module on the FI to cater the needs for the customers and other things. So load balancing is a small stuff. What is a big thing behind that? Everyone thinks about that. I'll just configure some of the servers on that in the load balancer. And I'll be specifying some of the subnet for that. And I'll be configuring some outside IP. Then they will be doing some SNAT or DNAT or something like that. Means like source NAT or destination NAT or something it will be doing. It's not only that, we will be able to do many kind of an algorithms can be selected for the load balancing techniques. load balancing in the sense like it is going to do the balancing based on the conditions of the server. Conditions in the sense hardware conditions. I can just say if it is a CPU has been hiked so much, you know, CPU has been so much in the sense the server is not able to handle the requests at all. Like so many CPUs, so many percentages come up, like 90% it is hiking up. Some of the other servers are quite free in the form, server form. So the load balancer can detect those load on the particular server and it can forward the packets to the another servers also. But as an application guy, we just need to maintain that all the servers are having the same similar data as well. So that clustering, we just need to make it. Later, we can push one of the load balancer in the front. So the load balancer will handle all the traffic which is coming inside and it is going outside. And there are proxying is also been there. We've been using a lot of proxies in the Windows servers and Windows 10 environment or Windows 7 environment also we've been using the proxies. This is also kind of you know, like a full proxy, like you can just say the load balancers are. So load balancers are quite good in the market, but because the every other network engineer required to know about the load balancing stuff. You know, load balancing in the sense like how to configure the load balancer, what all the pools they can configure, what is a virtual IP has to be configured, which algorithm should be used, and how to take the logs from the load balancer to analyze it. When customer complains about that, some other things are not working, some other server is completely omitted, it is not at all being served by the VIP. VIP means virtual interface processor, something like that. VIP, virtual IP, you can take it as. The virtual IP is not at all talking to my server, something they will be talking to that. Otherwise, the server is completely overwhelmed by the VIP. Always the traffic has been reaching that particular server only. Like so many other issues, we'll be handling it. And moreover, we'll be having some certificate issues also. SSL certificate, we'll be installing it on the load balancer on behalf of the servers to get updated. We will be doing the intermediate certificate also in the load balancer. So these are all the problems, day-to-day, daily problems you must be facing on load balancers. And as a network engineer, now it has been expected that at least in one load balancer, you should have some experience. Either it is an FI or AVI or Nginx or Citrix NetScala or many other, like anything on the cloud side like that, Elastic Load Balancer or something like that, you should be having it because it's a network equipment. Load balancer is a network equipment. So as a network engineer, you should be having an idea to how to configure this load balancer, how to maintain this load balancer, and how to upgrade this. There are so many versions are available on FI. FI is keep on releasing the latest versions of the OS for this load balancer. So we can configure this load balancer in such a way that it's going to feed our cater our needs for the, you know, like the customers and other things. So algorithm, defining the algorithm and finding out the algorithm and applying it to the algorithm, it's simply is in the hands of the network engineer only. He has to go through the traffic patterns every day, definitely. When it is a peak period, when it is a normal peak period, when it is a normal period, when it is again in the peak period in the afternoons, after the lunch or something like that. So we just need to handle all these loads to have a proper benchmark. That based on this benchmark value, we will be deciding for certain applications like that. It's like an application load balancer, I can say. So there are so many applications which you are running. One is like a normal server login, like Active Directory login, they'll be doing LDAP logins, they'll be doing. So there we will be using some different sort of an algorithm which we can use. If it is a database load balancing has to be done on that, then we need to deploy some different kind of load balancing algorithm. We just need to deploy that. If it is an application based application, in the sense as and when in per seconds there is a so much requests are coming up, and we have some web servers which are sitting in behind. So web servers, in the sense there will be so much of a traffic will be happening inside outside traffic will be so much. There will be a lot of requests will be made. And there are so many replies need to be made for the requests as well. So none of the requests should go wasted. Means like it's not getting answered or something like. So these are all like a different algorithms will be deployed based on the customer's traffic, customer's application servers, and the customer's traffic as well, the end customer's traffic. And the and moreover, we just need to find out that what is the CPU utilization is going to be there in the load balancer I'm talking about. What are the memory which we need to deploy for that? How much should be the hard disk size for that? And how many servers are going to get mapped under this load balancer? What is the throughput of this load balancer? When there is a heavy traffic spike coming up, that VIP can handle how many how many you know, like the type of traffic which can have, what would be the throughput like that in AWS platform? We have some 5 GB, 10 GB, 25 GB throughputs and all we can have. Accordingly, the price difference has been there. Or if you're going for an appliance in the sense it's a hardware box. FI hardware box, when you're taking that, every hardware box has got its own number of ports as well as the number of, you know, the bandwidth parameters which can be tuned, and we can have some maximum on this. It depends on that. We cannot just add more servers to the same load balancer. We have load balancer, no, it'll handle it like, not in that way. So every load balancer has got its own criteria and it's got its own kind of, you know, characteristics are behind that. This much CPU has to be there, this much RAM has to be upgraded. This is the version that FI load balancer can help us. How many VAPs can be created? How many pools can be created? What kind of an algorithm has been supported on that? How do we redirect the logs to the syslog servers? How we are going to log into that service? How many people are allowed to log into that? How many people are, you know, like allowed to configure the pools and the servers as well, like nodes which we are going to create on this. So like so many factors are involved in this. And load balancer will be maintained mostly by the L1 people only. Means the layer level one peoples, they will be collecting the logs, or they will be just analyzing what went wrong by just seeing that log, error log, which is coming up like that. They just need to go and, you know, like analyzing the logs with the help of the L2 engineers. They may have to create the tickets and they'll have to put their update on that. They may have to log into the FI load balancer and collecting all the logs and finding out what went wrong on that. And they may have to find out the server health also. Health in the sense, whether it has been properly running or whether it has been overwhelmed, or the applications are properly running on there. Either it may be a Java guy's responsibility. Means if a database server has been maintained, means DB engineers will be there. But still, you are doing the load balancing for the database engineers. So you may have to interact with those people to understand the traffic pattern and the network card configurations, like what is the throughput has been configured on the network card so that the individual servers can handle the load. Like it depends on so many factors involved in the entire network. So maybe like people will be accessing from America to the Bangalore, or the people will be accessing from Singapore to Delhi, something like that. So that distance also makes sense. How far the people are coming up, how much milliseconds it's been taking to reach the end server or the end FI load balancer. So these are all the network activities, daily, day-to-day activities, which we normally do that. And with the cases only, we'll be able to handle all these things. So about this and all, we will be discussing that. And as usual, at the end of this demo, at this end of this session, I would like to show you one small demo on that. I have installed the FI load balancer in my own laptop. In that laptop, I have the 16 GB and i7 processor, which has been running on. And that FI load balancer doesn't take much memory for that, because we are not going to install many of the VAPs or servers going to get installed. But for practicing purpose, this much configuration is very much required, very much enough for that. Minimum 8 to 10 GB is required in your laptop so that you can run the FI load balancer with the three servers. At least three servers we need to install. Either it is a web server or a FTP server or maybe some other application servers. It depends on you. But I have installed the web servers on that. In that web servers, we'll be doing the load balancing between the with using the FI, we can do the load balances on this. So that kind of a small laboratory scenario, which I will be able to show you. And some of the logs also I'll be showing you. Some of the like CLI logins also we can able to make that with an FI. So first we will go through the slides first. Be with me, let me close this and I'll make it to maximize this one. This is also FI, FI load balancer. So this is called as an application delivery. Application delivery in the sense, what is going to get delivered through the FI? They say take it as like an FI. This is an FI. Like that. So here, this is a big IP LTM ASM Firepass. This is a big IP LTM GTM like that. And this is a user applications and application performance. This is a storage growth. This is a unified security enforcement and access control. This is a big IP LTM GTM and so many other things are involved. So these are nothing but the data which we are handling it. By the FI load balancer, we are going to handle this data. AAA, data protection, transaction validation. virtualization up and infrastructure, server and application offload load balancing, remote WLAN and LAN, WLAN is a wireless LAN, and a central policy enforcement, endpoint security, encryption and AAA, virtualization, migration, tiering, load balancing, so many things are there. There is a storage things. User experience and application performance, that is nothing but asymmetric and symmetric accelerations. Server offload and load balancing things is required. And then the WAN virtualization will go with the file virtualization, DC to DC accelerations, virtualized VPN access. So many things which we are doing on this. This is a people, applications and data. This much has been, should be there in our network. It's been already been there. We are doing a certain solution like load balancing stuff, which we are going to do on this. How to achieve this requirement? I say that multiple point resources, solutions are there here. He is an application developer. He would like to push it something. This guy requires a more bandwidth for that. Adding more infrastructure, hire an army of developers. Like in the sense, when we, the requirements are going heavy, much heavy, when it is going very high rate like that. So we just need to maintain all these things, like we just need to hire some more people for to manage all these things, or we just need to have a heavy duty solutions which we like to have, or multi-point solutions which we can go for. These are all the challenges are faced by the network administrator and application developers. So this is like the traditional infrastructure model. Traditional infrastructure model is like corporate employees from the LAN and WAN, LAN and WLAN, sorry. Mobile employees who are coming roaming everywhere. Remote employees are who are sitting in different cities and they're accessing. Branch employees of LAN and WLAN means like Bangalore is a headquarters in the sense some of the branch offices will be there in all over India. Customers, partners and employees. This is like a third party connections on this. So how do we connect all these applications and services to the right people and at the right moment in time using right amount of resources, meet my all SLAs, that is more important, service level agreements, ensure the security and save money. This is the cloud services, here the hosted applications, here the corporate data center, this is the SaaS, and this is an application, other delivery control, other things. So how we are going to manage all these things? This is not a traditional infrastructure model. Somehow we are facing the same model at least now also, even nothing has been changed. This is made like a percentage of the traffic which is going to the cloud may be higher, but still we are using some lot of on-prem as well as the branch offices connections also. So the result is a growing network problem. Users coming from the mobile phone, PDAs, laptop, desktop and co-locations. And we'll have to do the DoS protection. This is like a network point solutions. SSL acceleration is required. Rate shaping and packet shaping and other things required. Server load balancing, content acceleration, connection optimization, application firewall, traffic compressions. These are all we require. And here the applications which are coming in. So this applications also coming into the network point solutions. Users also coming into that because they would like to connect to that. CRM is like a customer relationship management tool, which we are using some ticketing servers and SNMP and all. So these are all customized applications, ERP applications, cloud applications. Those are all required to manage properly. So how do we going to make the load balancing stuff for that? So what is required to fill the gap? Unification. So integration, visibility, context and action. These are all things which we require. Unification enables the dynamic infrastructure. Like that unified application data delivery model, cloud infrastructure, which we are going to normally, now the percentage of the traffic which has been going beyond that is nothing but like nowadays 80% of the traffic has been towards the cloud only. So in cloud also we require to use the load balancers. Definitely. We are also installing a lot of cloud load balancers as well. FI has also been installed in the cloud. There is nothing left out as such because we have different models of cloud, like FI has been there. Appliance models which we normally install in the on-premises and branch offices as well. But when it goes to the cloud model, in the sense we require to have the virtual. Virtual in the sense it should be of software load balancing. We need to install it in some other virtual machine or something. Okay, the next one. FI is integrated solution. So application delivery network, secure, availability and faster. TMOS means it's a traffic manager OS. That is what the operating system, which has been used by FI in its own boxes. So this traffic manager solution, traffic manager OS will handle all these things, mobile phone, PDA traffic, laptop traffic, desktop traffic, and co-location traffic. Co-location means you can just say that either it is an on-premises or is it an on-premises or like, you know, you go for a kind of a branch office connectivity or something like that. So applications in the sense, CRM database, Siebel, BE, legacy, .NET, SAP, so many other things. So those are all coming into the application delivery network. The application delivery network, application delivery control, ADC discovers. So by the help of the TMOS, traffic manager operating system, traffic manager shell, we will be able to configure that FI to meet all our requirements. Go to the next. Any field application infrastructure services delivering DOS and DDoS protections, brute force attacks protection, comprehensive load balancing, advanced application switching, customized health monitoring, so many other things are there, IPv6 gateway, DOS and SYNFLAP protection. These are all, you can have it like, because when you are adding more modules to that, not only the local traffic manager, when you are adding the global traffic manager, as well as the application security manager, or the application side, what is that, policy manager, something, some module is there. Like that, when we are adding all these modules to the FI, so it will be giving you the unified infrastructure for you. That is what is being given, DC to DC data flow, that should be more of accelerated. So connection pooling, intelligent compression, L7 rate shaping, content pooling and buffering, TCP optimizations, content transformation, caching and TCP Express. These are all being done by our FI box. And we have, as I told you, that it is not only available on the physical appliances, it is possible to have it on virtual editions also. So the virtual editions are nothing but like a software which we can take it as an OAuth file, which I downloaded from the FI. Legally, we can download it. You don't need to go and crack anything anywhere. It is not required at all. FI is giving you freely that OS which we can download it and we can install it in any operating system. It depends on that. On the virtual machines, we can install it. Hypervisor, you can install it. KVM, you can install it. Kernel virtual machines, you can install it. Anywhere, you can install it. Only thing is that we just need to give some more memory and the CPU need to be allocated and the network interface cards need to be configured for that. So that your FI will be working perfectly in your laptop also, in a server also, or if you are using any kind of appliances like a boxes which you are having, hardware boxes. There also we will be having a different model system. I'll be showing you this in the next coming slides. The virtual editions of BIG-IP. BIG-IP is nothing but FI. BIG-IP products offer the same breadth of features available in the hardware solutions. BIG-IP local traffic manager, that is called as an LTM. BIG-IP DNS, that is called as a GTM. BIG-IP access policy manager, that is called as an APM. BIG-IP AFM. AFM means it's a firewall module, like that it goes. WAF, Azure Web Application Firewall. These are all now available under the module called AASM. It's called as an AASM, Application Security Model. It is called as module, it's called as. So this is LTM. This is GTM, we normally call it as. And this is Access Policy Manager, is nothing but APM. And these two are combined as, you can just say AASM. So many modules are there, it's involved. But as soon as we are activating more modules to that, we may have to increase the memory also, as well as the CPU credits also need to be given more. Then only we will be able to run that module to work properly. Else, if you are buying an appliance of the FI, then you should specify with your vendor, maybe the local reseller. Just need to ask him like, I am going to activate the ASM also, I am going to activate the APM also. So accordingly that I would like to go for a certain, like model number or something like that. So they will be suggesting you to go for this. So this is about the virtual editions. You can see something on, these are all the virtual editions, what all we are getting it. Centralized management, data collection device, and the virtual edition that includes local traffic manager, application policy manager, advanced WAF, network firewall, like that it goes. And technical specifications, what are things which you require. Supported platforms are VMware ESXi, as I told you. KVM, that is a kernel virtual machine, sits on the Linux based. Community Zen platform also we can do. Microsoft Hypervisor, we can use that. Amazon Web Services, definitely. AWS, Microsoft Azure, OpenStack, Google Cloud Platform. Like you can have all the supported platforms are listed on this. 12 and later, I am currently installed the 13. I'll just show you the version of it. And maximum throughput is 1 Mbps. Minimum disk space is required is 10 GB. This is minimum only they are saying, but better we like to have something more. And minimum memory required 2 GB per CPU. Better if you give around 4 GB or 6 GB, it will be working perfectly. Minimum processor required up to 4 CPUs. 4 virtual CPUs are required. And max SSL VPN users can be 10 simultaneously. And the DNS can be like 1,000 query per second. It depends on the memory which you are using. It depends on the you know, the virtual CPUs which you are offering for that particular virtual machine or something. So this is for virtual edition, you know, like package and specifications as well. So FI is on cloud platform, easy that AWS, Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud, OpenStack, VMware, Alibaba Cloud, everywhere it is. Alibaba Cloud is also there. So now these are all the modules which you can see that. Security, it's like a big IP, AFM, ASM, DDoS, Hybrid Defender, Silverline DDoS Protection, Silverline Web Application Firewall, SSL Orchestrator, and Virtualization. Hello. So somebody's... Okay, thank you. Please mute your mic. Okay, thanks. Virtualization and cloud in Amazon Web Services, BKB Cloud Edition, FB Cloud Services, FI, sorry. Like so many things which we can have. Software, what are the software which we can install? APM, ASM, GTM or DNS, LTM, centralized management. Nginx, it's already been there. Nginx has been acquired by FI, and Nginx is also providing a good, you know, like the load balancing stuff for that. And the hardware series, you can choose anyone. I2000 series, 4000 series, 5000, 7000, 10,000 series. So this is the big IP platforms. If you are going to purchase the appliances from the market, from the reseller, you can choose the model number, 1600, 3600, 3900, sorry, 6900, oh, sorry, man, sorry, 8900, like that many models are there. See that the models are there. These models are having its own way of handling the traffic. You see 1 Gbps traffic maximum. This is 2, this is 4 Gbps, this is 6 Gbps, this is 12 Gbps. And now we are using the Viperion. Viperion is like endless opportunity it's been given. So when we are going to buy this, how much CPU has been there, what is the memory requirement, what is the memory has been already installed, you can just see 8 GB memory. And here we are having the 16 GB memory on this. Like that, so many different models also there. According to your traffic and according to the service you are going to manage it, and according to the how many SSL connections are going to be happening on this, we have to choose the model numbers, and there is a platform performance has been given on this. Maximum throughput, layer 4, layer 7, maximum concurrent connections, maximum SSL traffic per second, maximum SSL bulk traffic, SSL concurrent traffic connections, maximum compression, how much you can go for. Switch backplane, how much is the backplane speed? Means like in the board, what could be the speed to talk to the input-output devices and all. That they are talking about. You can see the comparison list, and you can take the latest one also when you go to the Cisco, Cisco. Not Cisco, when you go to the FI site, we can find out that the latest, the comparison charts, we can get that, okay. Choosing the right platform, like that there are many series also there, 25 Mbps, it's a virtual edition, that's why it's called the VE, 200 Mbps, 1 Gbps, 3 GB, 5 GB, 10 GB. Then otherwise we can go for Viperion models on this. This virtual editions, we can do it only on cloud, as well as the, like a VMware cloud or something other we can use, on-premise or something. Virtual editions here, virtual ADC means application delivery control, is best for accelerated deployment. These are all like product specifications which they are talking about. Next, we'll talk about the physical FI, physical ADCs, best for like that it goes. And a hybrid, physical plus virtual, hybrid architecture. So you can go through this product documentations or pamphlets or, you know, like some kind of the papers which they are giving it, like a white paper, you can access that before buying any kind of, you know, either if you're afford to buy the physical appliances, it's well and good. If you're not afford, then you can go for a virtual. But in virtual also, if we are not providing the proper hardware to that virtual machine, then we will not be able to get the proper throughput from that. And we will not be able to complain about that also. Okay, the next one, FI architecture. Then FI hardware is in the down. This is the hardware. And this is the virtual edition is coming up. The TMOS. TMOS is nothing but traffic manager operating system. That is a traffic manager shell, it is called. Availability, acceleration, security, LTM, GTM, LC, that is nothing but link load, AAM, that is a web acceleration and WAN optimizations, ASM, that is for your firewalls, AFM, network firewall, APM, policy management, SWG, that is secure web gateway, web fraud protection, WFB, then the cellular, like geolocation database has been there, IP intelligence and reputation services, very close. So this is how the complete FI architecture, completely it has been controlled by the TMOS. TMOS means traffic manager operating system, which is controlling your FI hardware also, as well as your virtual editions also. And it will be offering this many of the modules to get integrated to that FI. Architecture overview, this is a global traffic manager, application firewall manager, application security manager, local traffic manager, access policy manager, application acceleration manager. So what all things which we can activate it on the virtual platform, LTM, GTM, and ASM, we can do that. This almost all things which we can do it, but only thing is that dependability is nothing but, we have to provide that much of a CPU as well as the memory requirements which are required for this. GTM means it's a accessing application, securing your DNS and other things. Local traffic manager, it's for deployment of load balancing and offloading and other things. And the firewall manager, data environment against incoming threats. Policy manager, which people, what are they are using it? What is the control of that? You can do that. Application specific security manager, that is an ASM. That's location visibility and threat protection. Application acceleration. This is for delivery and control, growth of bandwidth demands and other things. So like the many modules which are there. Now Nginx is also offering the similar kind of an architecture as well. I am planning to do the Nginx, but I'll do that later. Okay, anyway. Next slide, we will talk about LTM only now. Okay. LTM FI overview, consolidating the layers 4 to 7. Layer 4 to 7, in the sense here we are talking about the OS layers. FI architecture, setup and licensing, TMOS and networking, basic LTM components, load balancing and monitoring, profiles and persistence, acceleration technologies, security and SSL offload, iRules, very important, support and troubleshooting and IaaS. These are all the topics which we can discuss about that. So local traffic manager, turn your infrastructure into an agile application delivery network. So the users are here and your applications are here. In between, we'll be installing the BIG-IP. So BIG-IP will be handling the load which is coming from the users, and it'll redirecting to the appropriate servers at appropriate timing. So scale the application infrastructure, eliminating the downtime, improve application performance, secure application and data, increase server capacity, reduce bandwidth, customize the delivery of app for your needs. Traffic manager operating system, which we've seen that already. So here, this is sitting in between, and we have all these things has been controlled by this. iRules, compressions, packet filtering, TCP Express, VLAN handling, so many other things are there. Resource clocking, advanced client authentications, application switching. So this is about, this is the shared network services which are coming under this, shared application services which are coming under this. So this is the, just a comparison about that, how many applications which are going on, like a SYN acknowledgement. Because whenever there is a TCP connection is happening, there will be a three-way handshake has to happen. SYN acknowledgement and established has to come. So this will be completely controlled by your FI itself. This somehow we can call it as like an SSL offloading. We will see that when there is a session which is starting about the LTM on this. Unique TMOS architecture, TMOS traffic plugins, high performance networking microkernel, powerful application protocol support, iControl, external monitoring and control, iRules, network programming language. The programming language has been already been there. We just need to write the iRules. So iRules are very much come in handy when you are not able to do certain operations through the command line interface or the UI. UI means the GUI I'm talking about. when we could not able to run certain things, we can do it through the writing a network programming language. Don't worry about that. iRules are simple as the shell scripting only. It has got its own kind of, you know, syntaxes are there. We can learn that. It's not a bigger problem at all, because after the cloud, which has come up like that, everybody started doing the cloud formation templates and automation stuff and all. We are doing a lot. So iRules is not a bigger issue at all. When you go for a larger installations and all, larger installations, larger implementations, when you are doing that, so iRules will come in so much handy. So it's easy for us to maintain all these things. So this is how it has been monitored, high performance hardware, and it has been completed, like red shipping, TCP Express, SSL, traffic shield, like so many other things are there. You can see client is connecting to the server. Those, this many things has been done on, you know, like by the FI. Local traffic manager, more than just a load balancer, lots of LB methods, composite monitoring, geolocation DB, and more. Acceleration features, TCP Express, fast cache, HTTP compression. Security. In the security, we'll see SSL offload, full proxy architecture, SIM flood and DDoS protection, like that. So these are all being given by your FI. And what are the load balancing methods are there? Load balancing methods, normally which you will be using the round robin as well as the ratio. Ratio is very lesser. Wherever you go, you'll be seeing the round robin only, because that is a default load balancing method is being used as an algorithm. These are all called as a static load balancing method. Dynamic load balancing method, you can see load, least connections, fastest, observed, predictive, and dynamic ratio. We will see one by one how do they work in the FI. Load balancing methods, so static we'll see first. This is like a round robin. Client requests is distributed evenly, means like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Means like whenever this customer is coming up, let me take the pen. And this customer is coming up, the first server will be given. When this customer is coming up, the second server is being given. When there is a one more time, if he's accessing, the same customer is coming for another resource in the sense, it'll go to the third. Then if this guy comes up, it'll go to the four. Like, it's like a round robin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That is nothing but our round robin. The servers are getting rotated in between. Let's see the next one. This is a ratio. Ratio in the sense like 1, 5, 7, 2, 6, 3, like members are has been calculated with the ratio set to 3:2:1:1, something like that. We just need to configure this ratio things by seeing the traffic pattern, which has been accessed by the customers and as well as this is their static method. Static, because it has become a static, so it cannot do anything more, because we are going to set it up like, now we will see the dynamic. Come on. This is the least connections. In the least connections, clients next request go to the device with the fewest open connections. Yeah, LTM will be finding out which are all the servers are getting overwhelmed. You just see that current connections are 470 is here, 461 is here, 460 connections are there. This has got only 459. If there is any connection comes in, means like if this one of the people would like to access the server in the sense, this LTM will be monitoring that who is having the least connection, concurrent connections which are there. So 459. So the query which will, if it comes from here, it will directly forward to this, because this is having the least compared to the other connections. So it's simple, but it has been done dynamically. That is more important. Dynamically in the sense, FI will take the decision based on the server concurrent connections. Next one is the fastest connection. Next request to member with the fastest outstanding layer 7 requests. 10 requests, 17 requests, like that. Whoever is doing the faster replying, means whoever in the sense the server I'm talking about. The server which has been responding very quickly and it is having the very good, like kind of infrastructure is there. The server has got a good capability to handle the customers in the sense. Those servers are given more requests. That is called as the fastest connections. This is also dynamic. And another one is an observed. Less connections ratio is 3. More connection ratio is 2. This is somewhat, you know, like confusing on under the dynamic. This is an algorithm which is running in the FI, to find out that what is the ratio of the connections which are made on the servers. So that made on the servers, based on that, the connections will are given. That is nothing but observing the load, then giving the connection towards the server. The last one, predictive. Less connections ratio 4, more connections ratio 1. So this is also ratio, but this ratio will be determined by the load balancer itself. So these are all dynamic, and simulating all these in our laboratory environment may be a harder, but we can still try that. Yes, we just need to activate the load on the servers to find out that whether our dynamic load balancing is properly working or not. So the next one, priority group activation. Priority group, in the sense we will be creating two priority groups. One is a secondary, one is a primary and one is a secondary. Secondary will be keep on waiting unless and until the priority 10 has got overwhelmed with the traffic. If the priority group activities activation set to 2 and the 3 is the highest priority members available, lower priority members are not used at all. Means like, see, if this is a priority is a 5, here the priority is 10. So priority 10 people will be getting, priority 10 servers will be getting more requests on this. Priority 5 will not be used at all. When this is getting overwhelmed completely, then it may be looking for a priority 5. But then it may be sending the traffic to the lower priority servers. So this is also kind of, it's a dynamic only, but we can configure the priority. And priority group activation, one more was there. Okay, it's gone. Then we will be doing the monitoring like that. Monitoring the pool members, virtual server profiles, persistence cookies, SSL offload, and iRules. These are all we will be seeing in the next. Monitor status reporting, like available will be green dot. Unknown will be blue square. Offline will be red diamond. You can just see that, because it will be by seeing this, like the colors only, we will be able to identify that what went wrong with the service. You'll be able to see it in the monitoring. So by seeing this, we can just go ahead and check it with the server team that even there is something is going on in your server, please go do that, something like. So it'll be giving us the information about this. General, child, parent, client, like that, so many things are there. You just need to go through all these things. But it is like, when it is a green dot, you don't have any problem at all. When there is a blue square, there is a small problem, something is there. When there is a red, it is completely out of the picture. Means we just need to immediately call the server guys to talk to something. So we just need to take immediate action for that. Virtual server profiles, system supplied configuration tool that aids you in managing the application traffic. Profile creations, we can do that, because this also can be done through your iRules, and we can create it in the GUI also. Defines how a virtual server packets, processing the packet it receives. Can be associated with one or more virtual servers, means we can create one template, we can apply it to many virtual servers as well. Virtual servers are nothing but the VIP. That's what we call it as a virtual server. VIP, that is called as virtual IP. That is a VIP, that is a virtual server, I'd say. And different profile types, we can take it like TCP, UDP, L7 profile, HTTP, FTP, DNS, so many things which we can create. Based on our requirement, we'll be creating the virtual server profiles. The next one, persistence. Persistence is like that, when a customer requires to talk to the same server every time, then we can set some persistence cookie for him. Means if it is an e-commerce server, this is a symbol which is when the cart symbol is given. If he's buying something like that, he's just talking to that same server only. In the sense, we require this guy need to talk to that same server only. So we can do some persistence cookies on that. Basic persistent method, simple persistence, SSL session ID, and the cookie persistence like HTTP connection. So other persistence methods, session initiated protocol, MSRDP, universal persistence, like so many persistence. Persistence is nothing but same guy has to receive the same server for the connection, because when it is load balancing, it should not go to the next server. Next server, in the sense, he has to initiate the connection again. The better we will be giving something static until his session is getting over. That is called as a persistence. SSL offload, these are all very, terminate the SSL connection at BIG-IP, not giving the connection going back to the server and getting terminated. Enables the use of iRules, profiles, and all. Can free up the valuable server resources.
includes consolidated certificate and key management. This is what I was telling about the intermediate certificate making, like that. The FIPS hardware, effectively insert SSL client certificate and information to the HTTP header. BigIP has a hardware ASIC to perform. SSL bulk encryption also can be done. Not only in software, it can be done in the bulk. iRules. iRules are myths debunked. iRules are slow. They kill my network performance. Another guy is saying, it's a burden to use this to make things of this granular. There should be check boxes or point and click like competitors. Like they are just doing that GUI. And the next one. Only software developers will understand how to write all of the code. Not in that way. It's very easy for us to do that. No one is actually using iRules, just a hype. These guys, so many people are talking about in the network, they'll speak about, but what all the myths are there? FI won't even support iRules for their customers. It is very much wrong. What actually doing? What is iRules? Programming language that has been integrated with the TMOS architecture. iRules work at wire speed, means it will be very faster. Based on industry standard tool command language, that is a TCL. TCL scripting, it is normally called this. Provide the ability to intercept, inspect, transform, direct, and redirect. Sorry, track inbound and outbound application traffic. Core of the FI is secret sauce of the key and differentiator. That's what I was saying. What you cannot perform in the CLI and GUI, you can do it on iRules. Why not just put it in the GUI? FI often productizes the ICE rules as a propeller. Functionality is moved to TMOS and GUI interface. Fallback of the HTTP response codes, we can write it like this, but there is no way to put everyone's customer requirements in a GUI. That is what the problem is. You can't do everything on GUI. We require coding. How it is interacting? Client-side context, server-side context. It's a layer 7 proxy, which we are sitting. HTTP request, LB selected. SSL handshake, HTTP response. Client accepted, server accepted. IP layer. Now it is going up. Like that, we can able to conduct all these things on this. Key elements of it. When HTTP request is coming up, so go to the pool, HTTP pool, we can select that. These are like a if, then, else statements. Basically, a small programming knowledge is required for you to write the iRules. You can learn it. It's not a bigger issue at all. And like it has been expected that this is an explanations are given for this, like how to write an iRules and all. And a DevCentral technical community has been there. FI has got its own DevCentral, like Cisco has got a DevCentral like that. So they also have DevCentrals, forum for FI customers for building iRules and iControl applications. FI provides technical documentation, tips, free sample downloads, and confidential discussion forum. Monitored by FI engineers and technical experts that answer the technical questions. Design, architecture, troubleshooting, general assistance with iRules and iControl. These are all things are done by the development center. You can visit this site to get all this information for your FI questions and all. And as usual, certifications are very important. FI certifications are good in the market, and it will be fetching you a lot of jobs as well. FI certifications are a bit harder to clear that, but still you can prepare and you can clear yours. These are all the certificate map. The person has to start from 101. 101, then he can go to that CA, that is called as a certified administrator, 201. If he's a sales guy, he can go to the sales, otherwise it is not required. Then once you clear the 101 and 201, then he can go for any kind of a specialist here. BigIP LTM, he can go. BigIP DNS, that is nothing but a GTM. BigIP ASM, he can go. BigIP APM, he can go. Once he clear one of the certifications, let me clear this. This he clear. Then you can go to that security or cloud. So these are all mandatory actually. These are all the path actually it has to come from there. 1, 2, 3, then 4, like this. That's a number is also given. Okay, we will choose anything like that. But normally people will be going for 101 and 201, they'll clear it. Then they will go for a BigIP LTM. As a specialist, they will be making it. Then you can go for a cloud. Normally people will go for a cloud certifications. But cloud is, in the sense, you just need to work on the cloud on FI. FI, you know that is okay, but it should work. You should know how to deploy the FI in the cloud platform. FI in AWS, FI in Azure, FI in Google Cloud. That you should know that. Otherwise, it'll be a bigger problem for you to clear that cloud certification 402 exam. So one by one, it is like administrator track. Many tracks are there. Administrator track, technical professional track, technical specialized track,
solution expect track. So these tracks need to be go by one by one, 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. You cannot jump anywhere because there is a mandatory requirement is there. So you will complete 101 certification or 200 something like certification, then 300 something, then 400 certification like that we can go. So this is required. There is like one by one, like 101 what we are discussing in the examination, application delivery fundamentals. That candidates have the skills and understanding the necessary day-to-day management of the application delivery network, and verify candidates has the necessary foundation to pursue the FASA certification tracks. This is like more of a network oriented. You should know the OSI network, VLANs, you know, like configurations and other things, IP addresses and all things will come up. Stuff, very basic stuff. You need to clear this. Then you can go for a TMOS administration. That is a 201. Is the 201 valid passing score of exam 101 or valid FICTP is required, prerequisite. Here what we do, big IP status is like an administrator, you will be like passing this exam, so disciplines on day-to-day activities and basic troubleshooting of TMOS based devices, various application environment, and as installed, configured, implemented, individual may choose this complete journey, move towards next one, like a 2301 certification, 301. Big IP LTM specialist and big IP LTM specialist maintain and troubleshoot. There are two exams over, A and B. So you'll be doing some extensive troubleshooting things and all you'll do. You'll take a TCP dump and you will be analyzing it with the Wireshark. And you'll be doing a lot of other modules also, like FI, like algorithm, based on algorithms and all you'll be configuring it. You'll start designing things like, so that kind of knowledge is required for you to become the 300. The next one is like a DNS specialist. If you'd like to go for a GTM based on global traffic management, this is people who are working on the ISP. If you are working in ISP environment, you may require this. ISP internet service provider environment. You require the GTM certification. People are looking for a GTM. Nowadays, customers are also installing the GTMs and all in the network. So better you can go for a GTM also. The next one is like ASM. ASM for, like we are talking about so many firewalls has been in the market now. Web application firewall we are talking. Fire threat defense, firepower, Palo Alto firewall, checkpoint firewall. In the checkpoint firewall and Palo Alto firewall, we started using the artificial intelligence and the machine learning to detect the newer machine coded viruses and other things. So those are all, discussed over here. Somebody's chatting, okay. DaveW@gmail.com. Okay, no problems. I'll send you all the slides as well as the recordings. No worries. So ASM, integrating big IP ASM with the platforms and products in a manner that application traffic proper, appropriate organization and policies, needs, requirements, and other things. So ASM requires like application security specialists like that. Go for the next one is APM. This is for application, policy management, something that comes like. So here we will be having the TMOS operating system implement, troubleshoot, APM module. We will be handling that AD and LDAP integrations and other things, monitoring the user activity, things which is going on. Somebody else, okay, they are all giving the emails, no problems. And the security, then it is a specialization. You'll become the solution expert, something like security solutions. So you see that prerequisite is like a so huge list. You have to come across 101, 201, 301, then 401, like that you'll come on this. Then the A04, that is in a cloud module implementations on this. So like FI certified, we can go through these certifications once more. You will be starting with the certification 101 first. It's a basic stuff. Then you'll go for a 201, that is a TMOS administration. You will be given a CA, that is called a certified administrator. And third, it's like that you will be going for a specialist, either LTM specialist or a GTM specialist or ASM specialist or APM specialist. Once you completed any one of this, means all three, then you will come back to the security solutions or cloud solutions. So this is about your certification point of view. Then if you'd like to have any kind of more information about the products or many other things, request recording. Okay, thanks. I'll give it to all the people. No worries. And you can go to these links which are in the screen and you can see all these things, whatever you require for this. Maybe like these are all bit older links, better you can visit the FI site to find out all these things. If you search it all in the Google, you may find out the exact document you'll be receiving it. The FI University has also been there. They will be teaching this about FI courses and other ones. And the partners, if you can go for this, then here, application traffic management, application brief, solution brief, so many other things are there, you can go for this. Next. So as usual, I would like to give you my details about this. You can contact me on my WhatsApp number, and you can contact me on Signal as well as Telegram also, the same number I'm using there everywhere. You can send me an email to find out the courses and what are the details of that, how long will it take, what are the requirements from your side to make it up so that you can take these courses, what is the hardware software requirement, how much is the fees for that course, that is very important. So these are all, you can get this when you can talk to me directly, and you can subscribe to my YouTube link. This YouTube link is there, please note down. This YouTube link, you can subscribe to that. I will be putting all the recordings over there. It's a free, you can access it. Many other labs and arrays also I used to put on that. So you can see that. And this is my website. It's also been there. You can visit that to see what all the courses I'm offering on this. So if you have any questions currently, which is make up in your mind now, so you can ask me any questions regarding anything which you would like to ask me. I can able to answer that. Please unmute your mic and talk to me. Hello. Yeah, I see more people are there now today.
Yeah, hi, Ramnath. Ram here. What is FIPS key? It's like HSM?
IPS.
FIPS, FIPS.
FIPS means it's like intrusion prevention, something it comes like. That is normal security stuff only. IPS is like an intrusion prevention system only. That is nothing new in that.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions from anyone? You can ask me about anything. I used to offer these courses as well. FI, FI LTM, GTM, ASM, all three courses I'm offering. So you can contact me about the courses for that. You know, maximum the time duration for the course, each module may be like around 20 days. We can finish it. And we will be seeing the CLI, GUI, as well as iRules also. Means command line interfaces and the graphical user interface, as well as the iRules writing on the iRules to create.
Are you provide lab facility also?
Lab facility in the sense, if you come up with your laptop, it's nice. If you don't have it at all, I will be providing my laptop access to you at the time of sessions. Definitely I can provide that. You can create everything on my own laptop and you can practice it. It's possible. But I would like to...
I have laptop, but in a laptop, like there is so many resources required for FI, like all labs.
That's what I was telling you. Like, see, 4 GB minimum, 4 GB if you give for a FI LTM is enough. And 3 small servers we just need to install. Every server require at least a 512 MB. That's it. So 4 + 1, 5. 5.5, around 6 GB you take it. Everything is ready. Then you require at least 2 GB to be your Windows 10 platform. That's it. If you have 8 GB in your laptop, with an i5 processor is also okay. We can run beautifully FI LTM without any problems at all. Even GTM also we can do that. Only the problem is coming up when you are having the ASM need to be implemented in your laptop. You require minimum 6 GB should be given for FI only, then other resources will come up. So better if you have 12 GB in your laptop, we can do the ASM. Else with the minimum 8 GB, we can do everything else, all the FI, GTM as well as LTM also. You don't require much heavy resources at all. Not required at all. Okay.
Okay.
If you are having any issues in accessing your laptop or something, at the time of sessions, I will be giving my access. You can do all the practice. Everything you can do that. And we will record it also. Every session you can record it and you can practice it on your own. At the time of free time, you can do that. That's possible. FI doesn't take much resources as well. I'm not telling that. Because we are not having any much heavy load as such. We are just having only the simple, very simple basic servers we are going to have it. We need to see how to configure it. We need to see how the traffic pattern is going on. We have to check what profiles we are going to create it. And we are going to determine that what kind of a methodology which we are going to use for load balancing techniques. This you require hands-on, that's it. Then once you are in a job, you are free to do anything you want. You'll be having the plenty of resources in your hand to can do that. But as for personal learning purpose, it's very much enough that if you have around 8 GB in your laptop, it is more than enough. We don't require more. That I can assure you. We can see every other lab scenario with the under 8 GB. It's possible. Okay. So any other questions from people?
Hi, Ramnat. Appreciate. Yes. Whether you are going to start it from scratch?
Yes, of course. I will be starting from scratch, like VLAN, IP addressing things, and installing of the DeFi boxes, getting the license from the DeFi site. You know, like every individual with a Gmail address or any other email address can get 30 days evaluation license from FI site itself. Legally, you can get that. And legally, you can download the software also. FI software also, you can download that. Everything is legal. From there, I will be starting off. Then we will be installing the web servers also. And web servers, I will be directing you how to install it. And we will be seeing each and every practical by clicking or writing command lines. Every other lab, I made all the notepads for you to refer it. And we will record the session as usual. So we will start from the scratch. IP addressing, I will start. Don't worry. Submitting another thing.
Okay.
No problem. VLANs we require because we need to configure VLANs on FI. Mm-hmm. And virtual IPs, pool configuration, node configurations, algorithms configurations, monitoring it, taking a TCP dump and analyzing it, and opening up the Wireshark and analyzing the packets, how does it flowing, what is the IP which is taken by the VIP, and what are the IPs the customers are getting. That we will do completely, we will dismantle the packet and we'll be seeing. So that is from scratch, I can say that, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions from anyone else? You can ask me, I'm open to answer your questions. If no more questions, I can go back to the showing you the practicals on the FI. Okay, this is a FI I install. I guess everyone can see my BIG-IP box. It is a BIG-IP 13 I install. And see, you can see the 3 GB only I'm giving it, not more than that. 2.8, around 3 GB only I've given it. And 4 network adapters I configured. And this is the hard disk which is being taken automatically by that. Near about 200 GB hard disk is required for that. 2 processors I given, nothing more than that. Let me start this BIG-IP. It will take its own time, means minimum around 2 to 3 minutes it will be taking it. Once it has been ready, we will be able to see that in the GUI, graphical user interface. 80% I would like to show it to you on graphical user interface, because in L1 level, the people are working mostly on GUI only. When you go to the next level or something, L2 or L3, then you must be required to know the CLI as well as the iRules also. So 80 plus 20, I can give it like 80% on GUI and 10 to 15% on CLI, then rest of the 5% on script writing, that is an iRules, which I can give it. But if you are good enough to understand the iRules and you would like to go more on iRules, definitely I will be giving you more scripts to you, and I will ask you to write more scripts on that. That will be giving you like more added advantage for you when you are attending the interviews as a network engineer. So that will also be, can be done. It depends on the people's mindset. If they would like to do only on GUI, no sir, I'm not prepared at all, I want only GUI. Okay, we'll do on GUI. Whatever it is possible on GUI at your level, we will do that. Pool creation, nodes creations, priority group activations, VIP configurations, monitoring stuff, right? Like we will be doing all these things. So this booting up will be taking more time. It's a version 13. Now currently the version 14 plus something has come up. I didn't check it. But actually in our production environment, we are running 12 something only, not been upgraded at all. It's take some time, please wait. So the version 12 we are running, BIG-IP version 12. Now I installed version 13 on this. So we can upgrade it. I will be showing you how to upgrade also. And how to upgrade the OS on the BIG-IP platform. You can see that, not a bigger issue. And in between, I will be starting this servers also. This is a web server one, this is web server two, and this is web server three. See, this web server has I given only the memory of, let me show you the settings. It's taking time. See, 512 MB only I given. 512 MB, not even 1 GB. One processor only I given. 20 GB hard disk it is taking. Nothing required as such. No need to worry about that the heavy resource I require. Heavy resource, yes, definitely it is required when you go for ASM module, application security module, like, because it will be a firewall. It will be doing a layer 7 activity, like it will screen each and every packet which goes and comes in, like goes out and comes in. That requires a more CPU as well as more memory also. But LTM, GTM, you can still easily can run below 4 GB also. That is not a problem. i5 machine is more than enough. Everybody is having like a laptop nowadays, to at least to play games also, at least they have a laptop. We can run the same thing on Big IP Learning also, it's possible. Else, if you don't have a laptop or such, you don't have a resource, you can go and install it in AWS. But AWS, it is not free. That is a problem. Big IP may be giving you 30 days evaluation license for to practice it. But in AWS, if you are installing the Big IP F5, 30 days evaluation copy, you are not paying anything to the Big IP, but you should be paying to the AWS. For infrastructure cost per hour basis, it will be charged. So we need to calculate that, and accordingly, you need to pay daily. Daily in the sense, monthly, you'll be paying certain amount for that. Better go for a normal laptop, or better you take one rental laptop, at least, you know, that you can practice it and you can give it back. That would be nice. So I guess Big IP must be ready now. Let me go back and log into that Big IP. 10.0.10.128. Now it's ready. Guess everyone can see my screen. It's redirecting to that. 10.0.10.128. It'll be coming up. Take some time. Servers are ready and they are running. Take some more time because getting GUI ready will take more time. So this is the server which I am using it. This is a normal Linux server which I am using for as a web server platform. And the page which we will be seeing it, like, this is what the page which you will be receiving. Welcome to web server one. Like that, it will be showing web server two, web server three. When we are doing the load balancing, we'll be seeing the 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, something will be coming up. Let me see if it's came. Yeah, it's come up now. So I will log into this admin. So default password, you can change it later. So here, this is an FI box. So we can put a license as and when required. And 30 days evaluation license is already been installed on this. You can go to the system and you can check the, you know, like license. So this license evaluation, it's showing evaluation. Licensed date, April 17th, yesterday. License expiration date. Expiration will be May 18th. Means 1 month validation is there for me. I can activate. I can reactivate by putting one more license on this. License, they are giving it 30 days. 30 days license is free for you. And OS also free. You can download and you can use and you can practice. So when 30 days license has been there, this many of the modules can be activated. Active modules. This much we can activate. LTM will be there in this, AFM is there, DNSSEC is there, you see that? Rate shaping, everything is there. So all antivirus checks, firewall check, network access, completely it has been there. So no need to worry about that. Okay, and what else we can see? Configuration, you can see the device configuration, general. I'll just say, this is the name of the Big IP 13 demo.ramnet.local, I given the name.
And here is something like local traffic, general, AWS, DHCP, something like that, it goes on. So here you can just check all these things as well. And this is a disk management EC. There are two disks which are created automatically when BIG-IP has been installed. One is with an 83 GB, another one is a 20 GB. It's very less used, see there. So the very those, very less has been used on this. Software management, you can just see. This is the version of the BIG-IP which is installed, 13.1.1.3. This is installed on HD1. Like that, you can just see boot location, hot fix, nothing but like that, bug fixes and all, we can do that. And like many other things which we can see here, license, we see in that platform, we can see. I'm sorry. This is the IP address which has been configured on this BIG-IP. Like that, this is network. We can see the network on this interfaces, interface list. Three interfaces we configured. One is for management, and the other three are like, you know, like one is used for inside, and another one is used for outside, and another one is used for the high availability. With another BIG-IP, we can do that active standby, failovers, and other things. These are all the routes, default gateways being given. Self IPs, what is the IPs configured on the interfaces here? 128 IQ minutes, like that, it goes. And so many things, VLANs, which you can see. These are all the VLANs which are created, HA VLAN, external VLAN, internal VLAN. Everything will be seeing it, no worries. This is the FI active, online active edition. So this will take us to the main page of this. Then we can go to the local traffic. In that local traffic, we can install the nodes. This is a node list. I've installed already the CentOS 123. These are all the IPs of them. 10.0.20, 130, 131, 132. And this is the pools, pool list. This is a HTTP pool. This HTTP pool is containing the three servers. These three servers, all are green. We've seen in the monitoring, three green means they are working fine. And the properties, like it'll be like a common pool. Health monitor is a HTTP because all are HTTP web servers. And you can go for the statistics to see that how many packets are getting transferred. When we are accessing this server from the outside, this packets, bits and packets will go high. Means like it'll be keep on refreshing. And local traffic, let me see the virtual server ILC. Virtual server one, which I already created on this. The IP which I given is 192.168.1.175. Through this IP only the people will be coming out of this. We will be giving this IP only to the customers to access the web service on the backend. And the load balancer will be doing the load balancing between these three servers which are installed on this. So this is the parameters of the, you know, like properties, you can call it as. Source address can be any. Destination IP only, we give it to the customers as a VIP. Port service is 80 and it is activated. And these are all, we don't touch it mostly. And the pool, we'll be specifying the pool over here, resources, HTTP pool. This web server, this virtual server is, you know, like this virtual server is talking to the default pool as an HTTP pool. If we create many pools and accordingly the pool will get mapped on this, you go to the statistics directly on this. So what I'm going to do now is like, I'll show you the network map. So this is showing HTTP VS1, HTTP pool, under this, these servers are there. So this is the IP address I just need to verify, 175. Let me go to that Windows XP. I'll start this guy to access this 175, okay, nothing else. So the diagram is going to be like this. Let me make one some small diagram. This is XP box. It's coming from outside. This is the load balancer. Okay, this load balancer is connected with the internally three servers, CentOS 1, CentOS 2, CentOS 3. And the VIP configured is 175 is configured. I'll type this 175 on this Windows XP server, XP, you know, like desktop. When I'm accessing this 175, this LB will be doing the auto mapping. Auto mapping means it's actually doing the netting or mapping because this is sitting in different network, 10.0.20. something like it network. Here we are having 192.168. We'll be doing the netting on this. Then we'll be getting the output on this. Simple one. I just given only the simple for this demo. So let me log into this and I will be showing you that. Default.
So it has been logged in. Let me show you the IP address of this guy. XP is free. You can install it. Doesn't take much memory as such. So I will try to show it to my students always, like we don't require more IP. So it is taken as an 150 is an IP. And the mask is given like that. Default gateway is 1.1. That is different. So from this PC, I'm going to access the servers. Through the web browser, I will be doing it. So browser is starting on Firefox. Let me go directly to the private window. I'll be typing it http://192.168.1.175. Better I'll do one thing. I will be clearing my history. Clear recent history, everything. Clear now, done. Let me close it and I'll open it again. So we don't require any cache as such, that's all. So I'll go to the private window, then I'll be typing http://192.168.1.175. I'm getting the web server 3 on this. So it may take some time for me to refresh this. Then I'll be seeing this server 2, server 1 like that. I may require some time. Then it'll not be showing that. It takes a lot of time. We have to wait for that. Now it has come. Web server 2 has come. Then I'll have to wait for that. Web server 1 has come. So like when I keep on, refreshing, after certain seconds, I just need to leave it, 10 to 15 seconds, something like that. So then I will be able to get this web server 3 is coming. So now the load balancer is doing the balancing the load. So XP is accessing the server. XP thinks that it is talking to the server, but actually there is an LB in sitting in behind, sitting here. So he is accessing only the 175. So here the people are connected, all three are connected. Server 1, server 2, server 3. So when I'm refreshing, one by one servers are showing. LB is doing the load balancing mechanism. First it is sending the packet to the first server, then it is second server, then it is third server, like where it goes. This is algorithm, very simple algorithm we are using that. That is nothing but normal, what do you say? Now it is accessing the server. It is like a round robin algorithm which we are using. So this is about that. I will be showing you certain, the statistics which you can see. You see the HTTP pool. Let me go to that statistics. I'll be able to see that. How much servers are receiving what? In and out packets. How much in? Server 1 has got so many, 20K packets. Server 2 has got 17. Server 3 has got 34. We require to have a mechanism to check the things on this. We can do that. That's not a problem. So how many packets are hitting on the particular server? We can identify this. So this is about a small, demo, which I given it on the LTM. And if you like to activate other things like certificate, configurations, device, resource provisioning, we can go for. Here we will be activating the modules as well. You say that load local traffic, let me highlight it, then you will understand. It's a local traffic is there. It's already been ticked, means it is activated. It is licensed also. If you would like to activate that application security, ASM, we just need to tick it and we'll have to submit it. Then it will work. Then if you'd like to do the DNS things, we can do that. This is for DNS, this is for ASM. We have to activate it. It's already activated. See that it's already activated. It is licensed also. Again, you don't require any extra license to activate the modules. When you are getting one license, that license will activate all these modules in one shot. It's possible. But only thing is that you require the proper memory and CPU has to be given for each and everything. Then you will be able to run every other modules as well. This is a network mapping and this is a virtual server. Virtual server traffic also we can see. Here it is, 72.5K. 56.K is out. In packet and out packet, something which is currently going on. Like how many connections made? Two connections made. total 5 connections made. Like that it goes on. We can refresh it here and we can reset it also, not a problem. We can reset the entire counters itself. Then we can monitor. Now it is all set to 0. Now if I go and access it again through the Windows XP, I will be getting the hits over here, how many packets are coming in. So that's all for today's, the demo. If you have any questions, you can talk to me. Please provide your email addresses in the chat so that I can able to send you the recording as well as the, the PPT slides and as well. Everyone can give it. I have only the 3 people, Debu and Suraj and Madhav Chaptani, somebody is there, and Bhupesh has given now. Okay, good. Everyone can give it. I will not disturb you guys, but this recording and the PPT slides, I'll definitely forward it to you. No worries. I'll not disturb you like a normal institute or something like that. I don't have a time for that also. That is a different issue. Okay. And whenever you require some kind of, help or something like that, you can always ping me directly on WhatsApp or Signal or in Telegram directly, not a problem. Any doubts, even if it is not for the classes, session or something like that, if you face any kind of difficulties anywhere, you can contact me. If possible, I will be providing the solutions for you. Not a problem. You can suggest my, YouTube channel to the friends and relatives and colleagues. Tell them to watch it. And please, all the 10-15 people are there, please subscribe to my channel so that you can get the latest contents delivered at your laptop. Okay. And I guess everyone has given it. Thank you very much for that, whoever has given it. Nice. And let me copy this all. And let me copy it. And I guess Vishal has given in the last. Okay, good. So if you have any questions, please ask me. I will be going ahead and I will close this meeting session. And I'll be giving you another session on another topic by next Sunday. Please do come all without fail. You'll be getting more technical details. And I would like to have that more interactions. If this happening, it's nice. If you ask more questions on that, discussions happening, I like to have it more. Anyway, you can discuss it anytime on my WhatsApp or you can send me an email. And please do watch my YouTube channel. And in just the next half an hour, you will be receiving all the slides as well as the recording. Okay. Thank you very much for everyone, whoever is joined. Thanks all. Bye.